श्री कृष्णा श्री कृष्णा श्री कृष्णा, गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः, गुरु साक्षात् परब्रह्म, तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। स्ट्रेस मैनेजमेंट थ्रू स्पिरिचुअलिटी। वी हैव टू गो स्टेप बाय स्टेप एंड द थ्री स्टेप्स विच टेक्स अस टू स्पिरिचुअलिटी आर द रिलीजन, सेकंड इज द फिलॉसफी एंड थर्ड इज स्पिरिचुअलिटी। बट नॉर्मली व्हाट हैपेंस, we want shortcuts in life. Whenever we opt for shortcuts, we are cut short. And this is where we frustrate. It is something like this. In Yoga Shastra, there are 8 steps told for an average seeker. यम नियम आसन प्राणायाम प्रत्याहार धारणा ध्यान समाधि, 8 ऑफ देम। नाउ इंस्टेड ऑफ गोइंग स्टेप बाय स्टेप, वी डायरेक्टली वांटेड टू बिगिन समाधि द मेडिटेशन। सो फ्रॉम 0 टू डायरेक्टली 8 स्टेप, तो द मोर चांसेस आर we will miss, fall, and we will have problems. It is something like this. Once I was becoming more smart than required. So I thought, normally I take 8 chapatis, 8 breads to fill in my stomach. I am a big glutton. I can eat, eat, and eat. So I was getting so fed up, eat one, then second, then third, then 8th comes. So one day I decided, okay, now I'll keep 8 chapatis in front of me, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. When I eat this 8th chapati, my hunger is satiated. So why not I take the 8th chapati first? And I took that 8th chapati first, hoping that my hunger will be satiated, but it never happened. Then I was worried. Why today, every day when I take the 8th chapati, my hunger is satiated? Why today the hunger is not satiated? Because I have not understood. Earlier 7 chapatis contribute to give a credit to the 8th chapati that it satisfies my hunger. In the same manner, we don't practice yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara, dharana, dhyana, and then we want to get into samadhi. As this is height of foolishness, similarly, we want to be spiritual. First, we have to prepare ourselves. See, friends, have we prepared ourselves? Like for everything, there is a preparation required. So when we cook the food, preparations are required. When we are doing an operation, preparation is required. For everything, preparation is required. But when it comes to the spiritual path, we want shortcuts. And the shortcuts are, when we are unfit for everything, we feel we are fit for spirituality. Like one mother told me in Allahabad, because her son was good for nothing. Huge structure, 6 plus 4 plus 6 plus long and 4 plus wide, huge. Not studying, not doing business, not working. Eating and bullying both mom and dad. So when we are sitting for taking food, He was standing there in Vivekananda posture. So I told him, come on, go and join us. You take. I said, anyway, I have come for that. So his mother got very, hurt. She said, see Swamiji, how he behaves. He is such a useless person in our family. We are fed up of him. He doesn't study. He doesn't work. He doesn't do anything except troubling me and my husband. He is nuisance. Then she said, why don't you take him to your ashram? Meaning, those who are unfit for everything, they are fit to go to ashram. And this is true. If you see all the ashrams, all the problems come in the ashram. That is the reason, as Mr. Kapoor told, I don't have ashram. Why invite problems? See, friends. So, spiritual life is not for a person who is unfit for everything. So, I told that Amma, I said, Mama, what you are telling is true. My mother also sent me to ashram like that because I was good for nothing. So, she pushed me, go to ashram, Meta, you will be all right. First, prepare yourself. So, the first preparation was, we are able to take care of our mind from two standpoints, and that is achieved through the religion. And what I told you religion yesterday, religion is a self-disciplined lifestyle because of which our mind is no more obsessed with personal likes and dislikes. What is right, that is to be done. Not what I like, that is to be done. And see the fun in that. What we like may not be right. And what is right, we may not like. For example, early to bed and early to rise is right. But we don't like it. And then therefore, what is prosperity? What is affluence? When you can keep on hanging in the bed up to 10 o'clock like a pig, then we are affluent, we are rich, we are prosperous. What is prosperity? When we give too much choice to ourselves. See, the more the choice we can give, more prosperous we are. And what is the choice? Choice is nothing but obsession of personal likes and dislikes. And thus our life is guided by likes and dislikes. So these likes and dislikes are the impurity in our mind. And this impurity is removed by following the path of religion. So what is to be done must be done. Whether we like or we don't like. It has to be done, it has to be done. This is the only way we can clean our mind of the personal likes and dislikes. The second thing is, even if we are not able to clean our mind totally, yet we can at least assert that we are not the victims of our personal likes and dislikes. This was one aspect we saw yesterday. Now the second aspect is our mind available to us whenever we want or the mind is not available? So our observation is our mind is not available to us whenever we want. Bill Gates and Steve Jobs, they have taken this window business from the mind. When we wake up, you switch off your laptop. And whatever are your default settings, they will pop out. So whatever are our personal likes and dislikes, they become the ruling factor. And then we start, let us say, our japa. So in one window japa is going on. That time the second window opens, the third window opens. At a time there are many windows. See? And then complain. So visualize it for meditation. Why too many thoughts come? So normally we complain about the mind. We don't work on the mind. So today we'll try to see that we have to work on the mind. And when we want to work on the mind, we must know what we mean by mind. See, in his most wonderful book, Upadesha Sar, Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi, he gives an exhaustive treatment to this topic. First, we follow the path of religion, dharma, and dharma or religion is karma pradhan, predominantly action oriented, do's and don'ts. So when we follow the path of karma, we will be entangled. So to get out of this entanglement, we are told Ishvararpitam Nechayakritam. Whatever we do is not the manifestation of personal likes and dislikes, but what is ought to be done, that alone is done. Nechayakritam. And whatever we are doing for whom? We are doing it for the Lord. Whenever we do anything for the Lord, it is perfect, it is beautiful, it is fulfilling. Like suppose we have to offer some food to the Lord. Will we bring the leftover from our fridge to offer to the Lord? No. That is meant for the husband. Because when we give it to the Lord, it has to be best. See, friends. So Ishvararpitam, when whatever is done, if it is done for the sake of the Lord, then mind becomes Chitta Shodhakam Mukti Sadhana. First step. Second step, the mind is not available with us whenever we want. Then what is to be done? There the teacher tells, very simple way. He says that practice devotion. Devotion is practice for making the mind available to the given job. It is for this purpose japa etc. is instructed in our scriptures. Now the third thing, we may like to practice karma or the devotion, but the mind is not listening to me, then we practice yoga. Yoga is practice for installation of a software called as self-discipline. Life must be self-disciplined. And whenever there is a self-discipline, it's a freedom. When discipline is imposed from outside, it is a burden. When it is a self-discipline, it is a freedom. Like among all of you who have come on their own, they will enjoy. And those who are tied down with a lead and brought over here, they will suffer. Because anything we do of our own choice is a freedom. So, this self-discipline is introduced by the yoga practice. But this is not enough. After these three things are done, then the teacher takes next about the mind. Friends, if you want to purify your mind, if you want to make your mind single-pointed, if you want to discipline your mind, first of all find out what you want to do, what is that mind? We all talk about mind. But what is the mind? One person asked me this question. Swamiji, how to control the mind? I said, why you worry about my mind? No. I want to control my mind. I said, then you do your job. Why do you ask me? I am not your servant. No, Swamiji, you are not understanding. How to control the mind? I said, okay. I ask you something, you reply in your mind. And when I will say, Now tell loudly, then you tell loudly. Okay? He said, all right. I said, 2 plus 2, keep it in your mind. And I said, 4 plus 4, keep it in your mind. Then I said, 8 minus 8, now tell loudly. How much? He said, 6. I said, I am a failure. I can't tell you further than this. Now, where did you do these calculations? These calculations are done in the mind. And we say, we don't know the mind. And therefore we suffer. So let us find out. Manasam to give. What is this mind? When we thus enquire Margade Kritam, we will come to know Naiva Manasam. The mind will disappear. See, friends. And this can happen only if we are following the philosophy which is based on the truth and not the philosophy which is based on imaginations. If we are told, if you don't know this, you will go to hell, and therefore we do everything out of fear, living our life under the influence of fear is religion. See, most of the people, when they go to the temple or church or wherever, it is this, you know, more of a fear. If I don't do, what will happen? Fearful life is not spiritual life. See, many times it so happens, I go to people's home and then they give me food. And if it is a gathering of 5, 6, 7 people, you know, in our USA, it is always a potluck. You call it potluck, but it is actually potluck. What will go inside, God only knows. So, all the leftover is brought together in a potluck. And they give me first, so that if I survive, then others can eat. And they call it as love, respect. So, what I do, I take the food, chapati, dip it into the dal to search if there is something and slowly collect everything. And then, instead of eating myself, I just look at the food and then not opening my mouth but seeing the faces of all those mothers. With that, you know, food or the bread in my hand, their mouths open. This is called an identification. Then I see whichever mouth is widely opened, I call and say, Mama, please come. And she is so happy. And after she comes, then I say, Mama, before I take, I offer it to Lord Krishna. You are my Krishna. So she takes that. She feels I love her. No, it was a sense of insecurity. And after my food and everything is over, then she came and said, Swamiji, I'm sorry, so what happened? Do you know, today is Ekadashi. I said, why are you sorry on Ekadashi? You should be happy. No, you gave me food on Ekadashi. It is wrong. Now what will happen to me? I said, nothing. Straight away, hell, non-stop flight. Friends, spiritual life is not living under the fear psychosis. And for that, we have to know what is happening in the mind. So what is the mind? Manasam to keep. We come to know Naiva Manasam. There is nothing like mind. Don't give too much importance to the mind. See? Otherwise, whole life, you know, I want to control the mind. It will never happen. It has never happened. See? Engage the mind. Engage the mind, and educated mind is a controlled mind. See? And for engagement of the mind, there are many techniques. One of the techniques is in the Dharma Shastra. when we are fulfilling all our obligations, we have no time to gain more. Till morning, evening, you are absolutely occupied. Where is the time to get bored? Have you seen the children getting bored? They are so busy. What they do is not important. They are busy. Therefore, children never go in depression. We oldies, we get up in the morning. Oh God, another 24 hours I have to live. Now what do I do? We suffer never because of shortage of time. We suffer whenever we have got excess of time. Therefore, the retired people, in India there is one virus, VRS they call it. It is VRS, virus means a voluntary retirement scheme. And these people become VRS, retire, and then nowhere to go. So sit in the house since morning, then what to do? Eat, nothing else. And eat the head of that poor lady at home. See, because the mind is there a lot of time. So if we want to really control our mind, keep the mind busy. We should not have one moment free in 24 hours. Tight schedule. I'll tell you my personal experience about this. You know, I wrote one very huge book in 5 volumes, about 2000 pages. Those days there was no laptop, no nothing with me. Maybe about 22, 23 years before. So everything has to write by hand. To finalize one page, it takes at least 5 times. So 2005. Then, the second book when I took for writing, I thought, let me take complete holiday. No lectures, no nothing, and I finished it. And I took for 3 months. And in that 3 months, I could not write one line. Then I came to discover that busy mind is more productive than a lazy mind. See, keep yourself busy, occupied. And for that, we do our duties, no extra time. The second way of keeping busy is follow the various techniques which are given for controlling the mind. And one of the simplest technique is the technique of japa sadhana. Bhagavan says in Bhagavad Gita, yajnanam japa yajnosi. Now japa sadhana is done for working on the mind. Normally we work by the mind. We work by the mind in this manner. We have to do the japa. Because Guru Maharaj has given. So we take the mala in the hand and start. Om Guru Sadha Siddhartha Bhagavad Gita Nishchata Om Guru Sadha Siddhartha Bhagavad Gita Sima Om Guru Sadha Siddhartha Bhagavad Gita Sima Om Guru Sadha Siddhartha. All the gods get confused. Yaar, kya ho raha hai? Think. This is working by the mind. Now work on the mind. Working by the mind is working by default. Working by the mind. The working on the mind is, don't bother about the number of times we chant the Lord's name. But focus attention, how long we can keep our mind occupied for one job. That is working on the mind. Then you take, for example, sit down comfortably and find out how much time is at your disposal. Today I have got 5 minutes, more than enough. Now in these 5 minutes, I have to chant the Lord's name very comfortably, cheerfully, happily. This is the philosophy of mind. And then, when we know 5 minutes cannot be over before 5 minutes, so you have to be there. Now, when we are worried about the number of times we have to chant, we hurry up. Time is short and we have to finish the whole mala. And then our chanting the Lord's name in that way is like taking a, you know, Ayurvedic medicine. How do you take Ayurvedic medicine? We gulp it and take something sweet and a glass of water so that even the trace should not remain on the tongue. It is so bitter. That is the philosophy of Ayurveda. I don't know whether you know or not. They give you such bitter medicine to avoid the next dose. The patient says, I am all right. Otherwise, take again second dose. No, I am all right. In the same manner, our chanting the Lord's name is like the Ayurvedic medicine. Om Rosa, Rosa, Om Rosa, Rosa. Why are you in a hurry? Where you have to go? So now we start working on the mind. Suppose we have 5 minutes, then sit down and comfortably chant. Om Sri Ram Jai Ram Jai no hurry. This type of chanting is like eating a chocolate. How we eat a chocolate? We don't eat the chocolate and take a glass of water. We put the chocolate in the mouth, it is parked in the parking lot. And slowly, slowly we gain on sucking it and enjoy it. In the same manner, discover the taste in the Lord's name. Initially, it will not come because we have got mental acidity. You know, those who have got the physiological acidity, for them anything they eat, it sounds, it tastes very bitter. I don't know what you have prepared. Mouth is so bad. Even the sweet is given, sweet doesn't taste sweet. But keep on eating. The same sweet will become the medicine and it will restore. Exactly the same way. Keep on chanting very slowly. And during that period of 5 minutes, no other theme is entertained by law. Give it a try. Instead of sitting one time, 1 hour, sit 5 minutes, even standing or when you are walking. Let him just try this. Oh. Jai Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram. And then the mind will be able to remain cool, quieter, relatively. While doing this, when the mind becomes more and more quiet, then we discover many hidden secrets about the mind. See, like the ocean is covered by the waves, and the water is covered by the ocean. In the same manner, the mind is covered by the thoughts. So if we want to discover what the mind is, we have to break the barrier of thoughts and dive deep. Once I was in Cairns in Australia and we went for scuba diving in that Cairns area, beautiful, that you know, great reef or corals are there, one of the seven wonders. About 4-5 kilometers we went inside the sea and then the boat stopped, then they gave us funny kind of things to put on and then we entered the sea. You can float and see all the corals. And I was very uncomfortable with that long fins kind of thing to the feet and that funny kind of thing coming out of your head like a steam engine, you know, outlet. I said, hey, I can't hold this thing at 3 meters. I don't know. Then that person, what will you do? I said, I'll jump into the sea. He said, okay, jump. And I jumped. And you have a low God, this man, male form, weird fellow has come, directly jumped. And when I was at the surface level, the waves will trouble. Go up and down. But then I went deep. Maybe about 10-15 feet. I could touch the corals. It was not very deep seated area. Then I discovered one principle. The waves are troubling us when we are on the surface of the ocean. When you go deep into the same point, as you go deeper, waves start disappearing. Now apply this principle in yourself. When we are at the surface of our mind, we are disturbed because we are buffeted by the thoughts. See? Then go down deep, there only. When you go down deep, there only, as deeper you go, the frequency and the intensity of thoughts starts minimizing. And a point comes where thoughts do not make any meaning for us. This is working on the mind. Now you will see, thoughts have origin from two sources. One source is the objective world. When we see something and go ahead, no thought is created. But when we see something and start projecting on the perception, then that projection habit of the mind is thoughts. So mind has got two functions. One is perception, second is projection. Perception is in the God's kingdom. See, like eyes you open, whatever is in front will be seen. It is natural. Similarly, mind has one function. In whatever contact the mind comes, the mind knows this is a flower, this is a road, this is the house, this is a man, this is a woman. Up to here, mind is not a problem. But mind doesn't stop there. The mind starts projections after perception. This is how a boy falls in love. He doesn't rise in love. He falls. Because he has started projecting. So he looks at the girl and if he goes ahead, like, you know, we see so many girls in the world, we don't fall in love with every Tom, Dick and Harry. But one stupid girl, we look at her and we start projecting. Why she has come at this very moment to the temple when I am there? I think there is some God's divine message. Who is telling this thing? Your own mind is projecting. So, to work on the mind is stop this habit of projection by the mind. We being Indians, we have got special DNA. And the DNA is, we have opinions about everything in this world. We have comments on everything in this world. We can suggest even to God how he should run his business. An Indian is expert in somebody else's business more than in his own business. An Indian can take a decision for anybody. See, these are the projection habits on the mind. And whenever our mind is projecting, we have given a status of reality to those things. Our mind can project only on something which is recognized as real. That which is not recognized as real, the mind stops projections. Take an example to understand this. Once I was standing in front of Lord Shiva in some temple in Gujarat, evening time 5 o'clock or 5:15, and on back side there was sun. In the front was that small temple and I was in between. So my shadow straight away landed on the Shivalinga. Will I say, my shadow is more holier than me? Because she can directly touch the Shivalinga. Then, after that was over, I went. And I had to spend about half an hour in that area. So when I was standing, I am the same, the sun is the same, and there was shadow also in the open courtyard. And when it was like that, one doggy came from somewhere. And after he came, he found that particular spot for his abhishek. So he first of all need Atma Pradakshina, need salutation, and then Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachate, he did the abhishek on that shadow. Will I feel, oh God, what this fellow is doing? No, because shadow, we do not give a status of reality, is it not? Now apply this principle in life. Whatever our mind comments on anything or anybody, only because we have given a status of reality to these things. How simple it is. The day we understand this principle, that any experience which happens under n number of conditions, that experience is an illusion. The moment those n number of conditions are not fulfilled, that experience cannot happen. Like the mirage waters. Suppose I tell my friend I came late, 10 o'clock. I should have come by about 8 o'clock. Because only 2 hours drive from my place. So I should have started at 6 o'clock, 8 o'clock I could come. But I came at 10 o'clock. Then my friend asked me, hey, how come you are late? Yaar, what to do? When I was coming in between, there was a huge mirage waters. So at night you don't see mirage waters. Mirage waters are seen only in a particular situation. When the sun rays are perpendicular to the earth, then only those rays become refracted, and the refracted rays become corrugated, and it appears to be the waters. Because it is happening under n number of conditions, it is not real. Now apply this principle in life. This waking world where we are, when this waking world happens, only when we are identified with the gross body. If we are not identified with the gross body, where is this world? Think. The day you discover this principle, what we think it is so solid reality, it is not. See, friends, once I was talking on this topic and all our experiences are only images, they are not real. When this was said, the friend who was driving me back, he is ophthalmologist. He said, Swamiji, today you said that all the experiences are imaginations. I don't believe this because now I am driving you. I said, before you ask a question, park the car separately. Then ask me a question. Then he said, do you think the vehicle which is coming from opposite, I am avoiding from the accident, is not real? I am seeing that object. You see, it is illusion. I said, okay, my dear, fortunately you are ophthalmologist. Easier for me to tell you. How do we see an object? Object makes an image on the retina. If the image cannot be formed, then object is not perceived. Number one. Number two. What we see is the image, not the object. See, so what is our experience? It is the experience of only images. Be very attentive. And where are those images? Those images are caught on the mind, which is a virtual reality. It is not real. See, friends. So, if the mind is disturbed, images are disturbed, and our experience is frustrated. If the mind is absolutely quiet, at peace, undisturbed, unagitated, not suppressed, nor depressed, in that mind, the images are perfect. See, when we understand this principle that mind is, so mind is an instrument where experiences of joy and sorrows happen. It is an instrument. If the mind is closed, no joy, no sorrows. When the mind gets identified with the gross body, waking world comes into existence. When the mind gets identified with its own modifications, the dream experience happens. When the mind discards waking and the dream, then makes the absence of the waking and the dream as object of experience, then deep sleep happens. So, waking, dream and deep sleep, they are all happening only in the mind, not to me. Because in the waking I am, in the dream I am, in the deep sleep I am. But the waker is not in the dream and the deep sleep and so on. Therefore, all our experiences are happening only in the mind. Now, this mind, if we initially do religion, dharma, devotion, bhakti, yoga, self-discipline, up to certain level it is required. There is initial preparation. Thereafter start inquiry. What the mind is. Then we come to know, naiva manasa, mind is not. Now, how do we conduct the inquiry about the mind? Mind is an interaction between the I aspect in the thought versus the not I aspect in the thought. It's a very deep subject. Be 100% attentive. Every thought has these two aspects. Like, you know, this is a mic. How this knowledge takes place? First, द माइंड टेक्स द शेप ऑफ दिस ऑब्जेक्ट देन दैट माइंड विद द शेप ऑफ द ऑब्जेक्ट इज कॉल्ड एज द थॉट. नाउ इन दैट थॉट अनदर फिनोमेना हैपन्स द लाइट ऑफ कॉन्शियसनेस रिफ्लेक्ट्स एज चिदाभास. नाउ टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस थिंक वन ऑर टू एग्जाम्पल्स. If we keep a bucket with waters in the outside and there is sun in the sky, two phenomena happen. Number one, in the general light of the sun, the bucket, the water is seen. Then the disk of the sun is reflected in the water and there is reflection of the disk of the sun. Now from that reflected disk of the sun in the water, another ray of light comes out. This is clear. Exactly the same way. How the knowledge happens? This is mind, step number one. I know this is mind, step number two. Unless there is a knower, knowledge does not happen. Two chairs next to each other. They do not know each other because there is no knower. So this is a mind, step number one. I know this is a mind, step number two. Step number three. I am not the mind. So what is the mind? Mind is that experience where the I versus not I duality happens. And whatever is recognized by us as not I, about that we are bound to have a desire. There cannot be desire about I because I am me. See? I cannot have the desire for this camera, it's mine already. But I can have a desire for your watch because I don't have a watch. See. So, till such time, we accept anything as other than I and that is real, the mind can never be at peace. Therefore, first we have disciplined the mind, then we are now educating the mind. And as we educate the mind, slowly the mind starts disappearing. Now next step. This I who knows the object is one. And objects are many. Like you know, this is a fan, one object. This is a window, second object. This is a man, third object. They are many. But I, the one who knows the fan, the window, the man is one. So what is the mind? Mind is an interaction between I thought versus not I thought. Or in other words, mind is nothing but an interaction between the two aspects of the same thought. I versus not I. Now in this one, the not I objective aspects are many, but the subjective aspect is one. If there is no I, there is no my wife. If there is no I, there is no my problem. If there is no I, there is no my country. Everything is dependent on this I. Therefore, what is I? I is nothing but the notion of I, who is this I? So the mind is nothing but the notion of I. Now find out who is this I. This is philosophy. Philosophy is not going and telling somebody, come on, yeah, don't be frustrated, everything is like that. Nothing will happen. Socrates said one day, somewhere I read, every man should get married. If he gets a good wife, he'll be happy. If he gets a terrible one, he becomes a philosopher. That is not philosophy. Philosophy is knowing the working of the mind, how the mind works. See? And then we come to know I, when we use the word I, what do we mean by I? When I say I am old, I means body. When I say I am hungry, I means prana. When I say I am miserable, I means mind. When I say I am a successful man, I means intellect. When I say I am to Baba happy go lucky, Anandamaya Kosha. When I say I am husband, I am wife, I am brother, I am sister, I am mother, I am father, how many eyes are inside man? He is one, or there is a crowd of eyes. And that crowd is making a noise. Find out, what do we mean by I? Ayam aham kuto bhavati kinvataha ai patatyaham nija vicharanam. Then we come to know, when this ayam aham kutaha bhavati, where is this I? And when you inquire where is the I disappears. So what is the philosophy of getting freedom from these frustration, tensions, worries? Know this. Know the mind very well. When we know the mind, it can never be allowed to go into the stress or frustration mode. See, friends. Now see what happens. Lighter side. Nobody wants to die. So is the case for the mind. Mind doesn't want to die. Then what the mind does? To survive, either the mind digs the graves of the past and feeds itself on the dead bodies of the past experiences, or the mind goes on projecting imaginary problems and tries to solve the non-existing problems of the future. That is called worries. So to survive itself, the mind is either going in the past or going in the future. So if we want to control the mind, and if we want to understand the functioning of the mind, what is required is, first of all, define what is an uncontrolled, disturbed mind. So we come to know, uncontrolled, disturbed mind means that mind which is running in time, which is running in places, which is running from one object to another object. This is the uncontrolled mind. So what will be there for control over the mind? Control over the mind will be, the mind is not allowed to run in time, is not allowed to run from one place to another place, and is not allowed to run from one object to another object. These three things, when they are consciously practiced, then we are working on the mind. See, this is the philosophy of life. Now how this mind makes a fool of us? This point I told 100 times. One of the highest spiritual practice is this. Do not talk about your past. Do not ask anybody about their past. You have taken a very long leap into the infinite. Because the mind is finite. And whenever we go in the past, we have to struggle to remember. And the mind is more and more agitated. Agitated mind is very living mind. Quiet mind is attaining coma and ultimately die. Who wants to die? And therefore, mind will keep on struggling. Therefore, we have to practice this. Don't bring your past in the present. And this is the reason why old people are not accepted in the younger generation. Because what the oldies do? Old people have no future. They are only past. What they do? Whenever they are among the youngsters, they will open our box of the dead memories and start. When we were children, who cares who were you? We don't understand the basic principle. Nobody is interested in our past. Everybody is concerned about their own future. But we keep on digging the past because the mind has to survive. See, friends, for us there is no past. For the mind there is a past. See, friends, therefore, work on this. When we talk to others, we talk about our past. Be attentive. When we talk to ourselves, we talk about the future. See? So when we are sitting and keep on worrying means what? We keep on talking to ourselves. What is happening? We are talking to ourselves. Creating the problems and solving the problems. Creating the problem and let the problem come. We can solve it. But the mind has to survive. The mind is playing these tricks. See, friends. The moment we stop the mind from going in the past and the future, in the present, the mind dissolves into presence. Thereafter, our vision changes. The change in the vision is like what? We look at the cloudless summer sky, which is blue. And we say, oh, what a lovely blue sky. But we know that the blue color of the sky is nothing but only optical illusion. So there is no blue color for the sky. Although we know that, but still it is seen because we are functioning through the limitation of the eyes. So what is the disappearance of the blue color of the sky? Although we see that, but we don't take it real. Therefore, no project is taken to change the color of the sky. No. No need. Because we don't take it as real. In the same manner, all the past and the future has to be dropped. And see how simple it is. Number one, do we have a choice to live in the present or not to live in the present? We have no choice. We have to live in the present. Can we live yesterday? We cannot. Can we live tomorrow? We can. So what is our natural condition? Natural condition is to live in the present. So whenever we are in our natural condition, there is no stress, there is no frustration. But whenever we have to lead unnatural life, then all the problems will come up. See, friends, And the one who creates this problem is this thing called as mind, which is not. Pure consciousness is knowledge, mind is knowledge. The difference between the mind and the knowledge consciousness is this only. In case of the mind, the knower known duality happens. I am the knower and something is known, and the known is not I. That experience which creates the duality is the mind. Now that experience which does not create the duality, like I am, our being is not created. In just being, there are no efforts. If you become a child, not be a child, when you become a child, then you struggle. When I was, in class 8 or class 9, I think it was class 8, struggle begins. But when you are in the present, now, such a mind is necessary for the further state of spiritual life. Then the stress disappears, like the mist disappears by the arrival of the sun in the sky. In the same manner, the stress disappears. But we have to know these things about the mind. So the mind runs either in time, or the mind runs in objects, in places, first of all, in places. We are here seeing something beautiful. We don't remain here. See, when I went to Norway, it was so beautiful there. But you are here, why don't you enjoy? But we leave this place and go to some other place. One of my friends in Australia, Newcastle, his son is doing engineering or medical. When he was small, maybe about 10 years before, so he was in maybe class 4 or 5 or something like that. So I asked him, I said, hey, young man, do you go to India? Of course we go. Tell something great about your experience. What he told was the highest wisdom. Such a small boy, class 6-7. He said, Avani, when we go to India, we talk about Australia. When we are in Australia, we talk about India. Don't we do this? This is how the mind survives. Be wherever you are. There is no need to compare. You must have seen, when you drive the car, here people follow the rules, but in India, they don't follow. It is there, so what? You are making your mind stronger. We have to destroy this mind. See? Therefore, this mind must be killed. And the killing of the mind is this aspect of the mind, the aspect of projection. Projection in terms of comparisons, in terms of time, in terms of objects. So, either the mind runs in the time, past, future, or the mind runs from one place to another place, there is no need. Or the mind runs from one object to another object. Mind doesn't remain there. When I see somebody, I don't stop there. I have seen him. The moment I see somebody, I say, hey, you look like so and so. Was it necessary to say? The mind has to survive. See, friends, this is one of the highest spiritual practices. These habits of comparison between the objects, comparison between the places, comparison of experiences in the past and the present. This old habit of ours is the diet on which the mind is surviving. So to control the mind, we have to first work on this consciousness. This principle I discovered many years before in one of my journey. When one elderly person came, that time I was young and I was in the train and we were only two in that compartment. He said, "Oh, you are here, I am so happy. Now I can talk to you and you can tell me certain things about spirituality." I said, "My God, now this fellow is going to eat my head for the next 18 hours. I can't jump out of the train." So that time, like a terrorist takes out a gun, I took out a rosary, mala, and I told him, "Look here, in the journey, my guru told me that I have to do the japa, I don't talk, so please don't mind. You tell me something about you, I will listen." And I was playing fool. And then he started. My grandfather was in Baghdad. That means now I had to be prepared for three generations. Imagine. And he went and on and on and on. And the moment his spirit used to go down, I had to say, again the spirit comes and again he starts. And like that he continued for hours. And then he said, "My children told me, now you go to Delhi, Bombay is very humid, you have got asthma, you'll be okay there. And therefore they put me in this train." "Really? Then what happened?" "Then I talked to you." "Then what happened?" The moment you come in the utter present, you have nothing to talk. Recognize this trick of the mind. "But Swamiji, are you not telling about your past?" Very good question. See, whenever we learn from our experience, we grow wise. And wisdom is light. Impressions are heavy. Therefore, memories bother us. Wisdom doesn't bother us. See, like in our childhood, sometime we have touched the fire and our hand got burned. So we learned that the fire burns. We don't have hatred for the fire because we have learned. See, friends. And then we play with the same fire in such a manner that the burning ability of the fire is to our benefit. In the same manner, when we learn from our experiences of life, we will slowly grow wise. And one of the biggest experiences is this, that nobody is interested in our past. So why talk? Like wherever I go, the same question comes. "Swamiji, where from you have come, why you have come, why don't you die, how many years you are going to live, why did you get married, how many times you got married, did your parents kick you out of the..." No need. See, your mind will learn to remain non-reactionary. When the mind is not reacting, then the truth is revealed. Upanishad says, "Hiranmayena patrena satyasya pitam mukham tatvam pushanna pavanu satya dharmaya drishte." The truth is hidden under the glitter of names and forms. So what we see is only the superficial names and forms, but behind all the names and the forms is the same reality. Therefore, Satya Dharmaya Drishtaye, he who is bent upon discovering the truth and get freedom from this relative world must have this update about one's life. And once we understand these intricacies of mind, we will come to know that mind is a liability if we do not know the working of the mind, and mind is an asset if we know the working of the mind. Like, you know, we know how to drive a car, but what is below the hood, we don't know. In the same manner, we know how to react with the mind, but what is below the hood, how the mind is functioning, that we don't know. And then, what we do, we go on complaining. See, this fellow, they have taken money, use this car. I'll give you an example. This happened in Delhi. I had to go and catch the morning flight at about 7 o'clock or so. And I stayed for almost 45 minutes distance. And 1 hour before we had to leave. So when we started, I asked my friend, hey, there is petrol or not? Swamiji, yesterday 1,000 rupees petrol was put. I said, this is not the answer. Now I am asking you a question. Do you have petrol or not? Oh, plenty, don't worry. We went halfway, got the car stopped. What happened? I said, sir, I told you petrol. No, Swamiji, petrol is there, don't worry. Hurry and catch, catch, catch. And after everything, Swamiji, you are probably right. So I got down, and fortunately a taxi came. I stopped, took my bag. He also sat in my car. We had to leave the car there only, and I could catch the flight and go away. Afterward, he told me, Swamiji, I don't know how it happened. So he went to a petrol pump, got the petrol in a bottle, and somehow he reached home. And then he discovered there was some leakage somewhere. And therefore, he has to suffer. So we don't know what is below the bonnet or the boot. And we complain. Whenever we complain about the mind, we are not working on the mind. Stop complaining. Mind is disturbed. Mind is stressful. Mind is frustrated. Mind is depressed. No. Mind is infinite potentiality. Invoke that potentiality and be the master of your mind. It is possible. Not for a handful, but for every one of us. See, provided we know how the mind functions. And once this functioning of the mind is clear, then you will come to know, aha, mind is the biggest friend. Upanishad says, Amruta Bindu Upanishad, Mana eva manushyanam karanam bandha mokshayoho, bandhaya vishayasaktam, muktam nirvishayam smritam. Mind is the cause for bondage and liberation. When the mind is objectively influenced, it is the cause of bondage. When the objectivity from the mind is dropped, the same mind is the cause for freedom. Let us achieve it and be happy. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnah Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.